All right. This video is titled Long Range Precision Rifle Minimal Disturbance Cleaning Regime. If you've watched the videos before this one, you've probably heard a lot about the importance of establishing copper equilibrium in your bore. When we're trying to engage targets at extreme long range, especially small targets, it's going to be very, very important that your bore conditions are changing as little as possible from shot to shot. That way, when you set up your ballistics tables, you'll be able to come up with a pretty good firing solution that is correcting for all the different variables and minimizing the effects of varying bore conditions. That's how you're going to be able to pull off a first-round hit on a real small target at long range particularly. A lot of long-range shooters understand that first-round hits are particularly difficult. A lot of guys refer to that first shot in any particular firing cycle to be a cold bore shot. And a lot of the negative effects that are generally attributed to what people call cold bore shots are actually not due to a cold bore so much as they are varying bore conditions, particularly powder falling and coppering. It is true that there are some things that will change as the temperature of the steel changes, especially in a stressed piece of steel. It will warp slightly in some cases to have a measurable point of impact shift. But actually, a major portion of the negative effects of a cold bore shot are actually due to a freshly scrubbed clean bore, which is going to have a different point of impact than will a dirty bore. And for reasons we've discussed in a lot of detail over the course of the last few videos, copper equilibrium is very important. If we're at least in copper equilibrium, that's going to remove a bunch of the stumbling blocks that are going to trip you up trying to make first-round hits at extended range. So the purpose of this particular cleaning regime is minimal disturbance. So that's basically, in a nutshell, the basic premise of this whole cleaning system I'm about to go through here in this video is you're going to only clean if it's needed, because we're going to try to maintain our copper equilibrium as much as possible. And every time you clean your rifle bore, you do change the frictional dynamics of how a bullet is going to slide through there. That's going to change your pressure curve, and that's going to affect your point of impact. That's one of those point of impact shifts we're talking about in our internal ballistics series. So the point of this cleaning regime is minimal disturbance. Just want to make sure everyone understands this before we go on. Now, this particular cleaning regime I'm about to go through is only really applicable for extreme long-range precision rifles. So for a typical deer hunting rifle, a normal setup, establishing copper equilibrium is not really going to give you any noticeable advantage. So this cleaning system is not really going to be applicable to that. Also, if you're looking to clean your AR-15 or your FAL or your G3 or whatever you're using there, you're going to have a totally different maintenance program for that. So this is for long-range precision bolt-action rifles. And if you missed out on the preceding videos, I encourage you to go ahead and check those out so you see exactly what we're talking about. So the basic premise of this system, as we just said, is to only clean your rifle bore as needed. So how do we know when we need to clean our bore? Well, pretty obvious for most of you probably, but let's just run through these. I got three of them listed here, and there might be other things, obviously, that could happen. But the first one is immediately after use in corrosive environments, or if you have a lot of exposure to water or something like that. If you're concerned this thing's going to get corroded, then obviously you're going to want to go ahead and perform this bore maintenance. The next one is after the rifle becomes exposed to grit, dust, or sand. Now, this can be extremely problematic if you do get a lot. Sometimes you get blowing dust, and it can even be really, really fine particles. That can even be worse than some of the coarse ones. If you have sand in your bore, you're going to see that, obviously, and you're going to go ahead and take care of it. If you got real fine dust or grit, you might not see that with the naked eye, so you might neglect to go ahead and perform bore maintenance. And that could be a problem because a lot of this dust, obviously, is quite abrasive. And if you're firing rounds through a rifle bore that has dust in it, you're going to basically be accelerating your mechanical erosion, and that's not going to be very good. So if it's kind of blowing dust or something, and you can feel any kind of grit to the air, as soon as you get the chance, you're going to want to go ahead and perform bore maintenance just to make sure it's clean. The third one here is when the rifle becomes excessively fouled with powder or with copper. And the way you're going to be able to know this, obviously, is by performing an inspection. You're going to have to take a look down your bore. Now, reaching carbon equilibrium is going to take a lot less time than copper. Sometimes it only takes a couple shots to build up your carbon levels in your bore. And then after you take your next shot, the projectile is going to push out whatever carbon's deposited and you reach that equilibrium point for carbon. So it's usually not a problem unless, like we said, you're shooting. It depends on your ammunition a lot, too. If you're shooting real nasty ammo for some reason, if you've got a 7.62 millimeter out there and if you got a batch of ammo out in the field that you're using and it's particularly dirty, this you could actually have a problem, especially if it's old military ammo with corrosive primers. It depends on what theater you're operating to, what kind of ammo, what's the origin of manufacture and such. Now, when we're talking about excessive coppering, you're going to notice a difference in either your muzzle velocities primarily, or you're going to have a dispersion of your group again. You will have erratic performance if you have too much coppering. And that's probably the main way you're going to be able to tell where you're at with your copper levels. You can also do a visual inspection. It depends on what kind of rifling you have in your bore, how well it's been lapped or whatever. But you can take a look, and if it appears to be pretty shiny still, you're probably not going to have any problems. If it appears real dark and nasty, obviously you might have a lot more copper. You'll have different performance with different kinds of rifle barrels. Sometimes it can look really, really, really bad visually, but it still performs just fine. So there's a lot of different designs and a lot of different ways this rifling is cut. Some of it's button rifled, some of it's cut rifling. And, you know, there's a lot of variation there in how they're going to react to different levels of copper. So the main way to really tell if it needs to have a copper remediation performed is basically by your performance. Now, we haven't gotten into it in too much detail yet, but we will pretty soon. We're going to be keeping track of our muzzle velocities because those are going to change with bore conditions and with ammunition temperature. So that's something we're going to plot out on a graph and keep track of so that we can make the proper corrections in the field. So if while you're plotting your velocity, you notice that your velocity is starting to climb up higher than is expected, you're going to already have certain things like ammunition temperature curves plotted out. So you're going to know by how much your velocity will increase due to ammunition temperature. If you're experiencing an increase in velocity greater than is expected just by the temperature differences, then that might be an indication that you have excessive coppering. What happens is it gets a little tighter in the bore, and that creates a higher pressure, and that can ramp up your velocity a little bit. Another thing that you need to be aware of, too, is just the basic shape of the velocity curve over the life of a bore due to erosion. And we looked at this chart a few times, but you'll notice that early in a barrel's life, and we're going to talk about this in more detail, but earlier in a barrel's life, your velocity sometimes climbs up a little bit. That's called the hump. And that's due to micro cracking, increasing the pressure. And then it's going to slowly drop off as erosion starts to really kick in. So we're going to have our temperature plotted out, and we're going to know the shape of that curve as well. If you're experiencing something other than that that's unaccounted for, it's probably coppering, especially if you're keeping track of when your last cleaning was. You should be able to deduct that pretty quickly. So that's how you're going to establish when you're going to need to do a copper remediation. And that's also included. We're going to talk about that in this video. So the other way we're going to notice if we have excessive fouling in the bore is by shot placement. And if you're starting to get wild shot placement, like a lot of dispersion in your group size, you've probably got way excessive coppering going on, and that's not going to be very good. So before we get to that point, hopefully we take care of that. Now, another thing that a lot of you are probably asking yourselves is, well, how many rounds between cleanings are we going to have to do it? Like, you're going to want a number, like every 100 rounds, every 200, every 500. How many rounds do I got to go through? Well, the truth is that your round count between cleanings may vary dramatically based on the use and the environmental conditions, particularly that you're shooting in, okay? So it depends on moisture levels. If it's real wet or if it's real dry, that's obviously going to affect when you're going to perform bore maintenance, right? Also, like we talked about, if you got real dusty environments or if it's relatively clean, that's going to have a big effect, or heavy use or light use. For example, if you're laying down and doing a lot of shooting in a short amount of time, you're going to get a real hot bore. You're going to have a lot more copper deposition in your bore than you would if you would just take one shot and then, you know, relocate. So it depends on what kind of a shooting discipline you're doing. I mean, if you're varmint hunting and you're shooting prairie dogs all day long or something like that, you're going to have a lot more rapid deposition of copper. So it totally depends on, like, your cartridge dynamics, your load dynamics, like how hot you have it loaded. There's a lot of different things, how much time between shots. So it's impossible to give you a number of how many rounds between cleanings you're going to do this. Just a general idea for, like, my 338 La Poix Magnum. Right now, it's real dry up here. So I could go, and it's pretty clean, unless the wind's really blowing and it gets dusty or something. If I keep it pretty clean out in the field, I could probably go for years straight without having to perform bore maintenance. Seems like a long time, but you also got to take into consideration that in a big rifle like that, you're not going to be shooting near as much as you would with like a 223 or something. You're just going to take a few shots a day. You're going to take a lot of time, you know, figuring out your firing solution, getting everything dialed in correctly, and then, you know, engaging the target and going and checking where you're hitting and everything. So it's not like you're going to be shooting a lot with that. So it totally depends on what kind of rifle you're shooting and how fast you're shooting it and things like that. So the key here is clean as needed. This is a minimal disturbance cleaning regime. So you're not going to want to clean it unless you have to. So those things we just talked about that you're going to want to keep an eye on, that's how you're going to determine when you need cleaning. Primarily for powder and copper fouling, primarily copper fouling, you're going to watch your muzzle velocity. If it starts climbing for reasons other than the ones that you've had plotted out on your graph, then that's an indicator you need to do that. Otherwise, if it gets wet or gritty, you're going to obviously want to clean it there too. So let's go through the steps. This is a pretty basic maintenance procedure. So let's just go through the individual steps for the long-range precision rifle minimal disturbance cleaning regime. The first one is that you're going to want to insert a bore guide into the action. And we went over this earlier. The bore guide is going to keep that rod centered. We're going to be cleaning from the breech, okay? You don't want to clean from the muzzle. That's going to cause too much of a risk of scratching up your crown. You get your rod misaligned going in from the muzzle, and that crown is extremely delicate area. You don't really even want to touch that if you don't have to. So you're going to use a bore guide, and we're going to clean from the breech. The bore guide also, a lot of guys think that they can get away without a bore guide, but honestly, you don't want the throat region to act as your bore guide. That's going to be extremely brittle back there because of the extreme high temperatures, all the thermal erosion taking place right next to the chamber. So that's going to be brittle steel that's chemically affected and thermally affected. And you don't want the rod rubbing up in there, centering itself on the throat region. So you do want to use a bore guide just because it seems like it should not harm the rifling in the middle of the barrel. That's one of your most susceptible areas to erosion, is right at the throat, because it's changing the properties of the steel, if you remember from our erosion videos. So you're going to insert a bore guide into the action. That's step number one. Step number two is you're going to use a copper brush. You're going to hook that onto your one-piece coated cleaning rod. And you want a sturdy cleaning rod like we talked about before. You don't want it to be flexing too much. That's going to not be very helpful. So you've got your copper brush. You can use nylon too. That would be fine. There's a lot of guys who argue back and forth which one is superior. I use copper, if you're curious, but nylon is fine too. This is a pretty mild cleaning regime, or minimal disturbance, like I said, so nylon would be fine. You're going to soak this brush in powder solvent, okay? something like the Outers Nitrosolve or Hops number 9 is what I usually use. You can use any like mild powder solvent. That'll work fine. Next step is you're going to gently and carefully scrub the bore from the breech using the bore guide with 10 passes. Now, if you do exit the muzzle with the brush, you're going to want to take special care when pulling the brush back through the crown region so that damage does not occur. That's a real sensitive area, so when you're coming back in, just be careful. Also, when you're doing this, you're going to want to go at a nice, gentle pace. You don't want to rush it too bad. You want to make sure that the brush is turning with the rifling grooves, so you don't want to just ram it through as hard as you can. So after these first 10 passes, you're going to go ahead and allow the solvent to sit in the bore for a little while, and we're going to move on to these next steps, and then we'll come back to the bore in a minute. So let it soak in while you do these next steps here. You're going to want to be careful not to let any of that solvent leak into the trigger group. That could cause some corrosion issues in your trigger, and that wouldn't be very good. The next step is you're going to clean your bolt, and you're going to also use powder solvent for this, particularly the lug area and the face of the bolt. You're going to want to get in there with Q-tips or whatever and a toothbrush, a nylon bristled toothbrush. You don't want to use steel on this. You're going to just let the solvent do its work and get all the carbon off of there. So get your bolt nice and clean and then dry it off. Make sure it's nice and dry. You don't want a solvent sitting on there. So make sure you get your patches or your rag and get that dried up. Next step is you're going to do 10 more passes. You're going to re-soak that brush in the powder solvent again and just do 10 more passes. After you finish up with those passes, you're going to go ahead and remove the brush and attach a jag to your cleaning rod. And you're going to wrap a patch around that jag. And these are going to be patches also wetted in powder solvent again. And you're going to run them down the bore until the powder fouling is pretty much removed. And so you're going to keep running those down until you're not getting any of the black carbon removed from the bore anymore. After that, you're going to go ahead and run clean patches on that jag until the bore is nice and dry. Now, if storage in humid environments is anticipated, you can wet the last patch very, very lightly with some gun oil, and that should protect it from corrosion if you're in humid environments. You can use regular gun oil is actually what I'd probably recommend. That works pretty good. A lot of guys use WD-40. Now, we did talk about using WD-40 to chase out the sweets when we're talking about our bench rest break-in procedures. But WD-40 is actually a lubricant and also a penetrant. And it's also very, very hydrophobic, and it's advertised to displace water. However, for corrosion resistance, if you're worried about water in rust pitting, moisture buildup in there, what can happen is WD-40 is kind of a light oil, and sometimes it'll float on top of moisture. And so it can actually trap moisture in pits in steel sometimes. And that's why some guys don't think WD-40 is a very good choice for long-term corrosion resistance for like firearms maintenance. There's quite a debate there. I'm not too worried about using WD-40, but then again, it's pretty dry up here, so it's not that much of an issue. If you're worried about this, there are certain gun oil recipes out there and lubes that are designed to emulsify with water. What that basically means is that the oil and the water will not be repelled from each other. They'll kind of mix together, and it'll actually come out to have a better effect for corrosion resistance properties on the microscopic level particularly. You'd have to do some research to see what lubes are designed to do this, but the one that comes to mind is like Ballistasol lube. That emulsifies with water. And so that might be a little more effective for long-term storage. If you just put a couple drops of this oil, or even regular gun oil works fine, and run that through your bore, and that'll protect it from corrosion. The next thing you want to do is, step number 9 is clean the chamber using like an appropriate chamber brush and powder solvent. So much like you did the bore, except you're going to be real gentle with this. You're not going to be going in and out so much. You're just going to put that brush in there and just turn it a little bit. Now, sometimes chamber brushes can be a little hard to locate, especially if you got some of these proprietary cartridges. For example, like my 338 La Pua Magnum, that is more of a common cartridge now, but it's a little harder to find chamber brushes for that. But J. Dewey Manufacturing actually has some chamber brushes for the 338 Lapua if you're looking for them, or you can do like a search on online or whatever. I'm sure you'll find some chamber brushes. You just want to basically make sure after you get your chamber, cleaned up, that you're going to dry it using swabs. That's the next step. And then step 11 is you're going to remove the solvent. You're going to make sure you get that cleaned out of the bolt lug tracks. That's where the bolt lugs would lock in there. You're going to want to make sure you don't have any solvent in there anymore. Because the next thing we're going to do is we're going to lubricate the bolt lugs with the shooting grease. And this is pretty important. So you're going to want to make sure you get all the solvent out of there first. But after everything's nice and dry, your bolt is dry, and those tracks for the lugs to go on, those are dry. You're going to it sometimes comes in a syringe, or there's different ways this can be applied. But you're going to take a thick shooting grease, and you're just going to go ahead and dab a little bit of that on your rear mating surfaces of your lugs. It just takes a little bit of grease, and that should stay in there for a while. Also, you're going to want to lubricate the bolt body, and particularly the portion of the bolt where the bolt handle is attached to the bolt body. When you're leveraging on that bolt handle, that's kind of a point of tension back there, kind of in the front by the lugs, but also back there. And so you're going to want to use a thick shooting grease back there too. And you can lubricate the rest of the bolt body with a regular gun oil. Will be fine. And it's pretty important that you lubricate those lugs with a shooter's grease, because that'll prevent damage. You get real high pressure loading sometimes, and you don't want like excess friction when you're working that bolt. Sometimes there'll be a lot of pressure. In that case, will be fully expanded, and you'll have a heavy bolt lift, and that'll lubricate things so that you don't grind and hurt those mating surfaces in your bolt lugs. We took a lot of care. I don't know if you remember in some of the earlier videos we talked about the bolt lugs, but a lot of guys lap those things and make sure they're nice and smooth, and that produces real consistent harmonic action in your rifle. So you're going to want the mating surfaces to be nice and even. And if they're not properly lubricated, or if you have grit in there, for example, if it gets dusty in there, that can cause some damage. And actually, I've had, my Ruger M77 a long time ago, there was a couple high-pressure loads that got shot out of there. And must have been some grit in there or something, because the bolt was kind of stuck shut, and it was extremely hard to open. And if it would have been lubricated better, it would have prevented some damage to the rear of those bolt lug faces. So sometimes a guy learns the hard way, but that's an important part to lubricate. And those 13 steps we just went over, that's the basic long-range precision rifle minimal disturbance cleaning regime. Centered on cleaning the bore, obviously. Now, if you did submerge this rifle in water, if you got it extremely filthy, you might have to remove the stock and clean some, mud or water or whatever you got in there. You might have to clean the other components as well, give them a wipe down. If you have steel surfaces, I recommend using a silicone cleaning cloth to wipe those down. Obviously, when you set this thing in the rack, you're going to want to be very careful that you don't have fingerprints on any kind of blued steel. If you have like a salty fingerprint or French fry fingerprints on that rifle steel and you let it sit, if it's a little bit moist in the air, you're going to have like permanently embedded rust prints all over your rifle. And I'm sure a lot of you guys know what I'm talking about. You have that on some of yours. But that silicone cleaning cloth for any steel surfaces works pretty good. You don't want to over-oil some of these components, like your trigger group. You don't want too much oil. If you have extreme cold climates where you're operating in, or if it's real gritty, sometimes that grit can get in there and kind of make a sludge out of that oil, and that'll actually impede your trigger from operating properly, and that's not going to be very helpful. Also, if it's real cold and you have too much oil on there, that oil can kind of get real stiff, and it'll freeze up your trigger. And likewise with the firing pin hole, you don't want to use a real thick oil, and you don't want to just douse all that stuff with gun oil, particularly in real cold environments. So you do want to, it doesn't take a lot of oil. For example, one drop for any given component should be more than plenty. A lot of guys really soak that stuff in there, and that can be counterproductive. Another note, if you take the action out of the stock and you're cleaning that up, you want to be very careful when you put it back together, especially if you have any kind of glass bedding, if it's properly bedded to itself. You want to make sure that when that that stock goes back with the action, that it's very, very clean. If you have any foreign materials stuck in there, it's not going to mate properly when it goes back together. So you want to inspect that real carefully, making sure that where the action beds in there, particularly on the rear surface of where the recoil lug is on the action, how that fits in the stock, the recoil lug part. This isn't the bolt lug, the recoil lug. You're going to want to make sure that's clean when it goes back in so that it's mating with 100% of the contact. You know what I'm saying? But it's pretty obvious what's going to need cleaning when you take it apart. Just make sure it's nice and clean. Muzzle brakes, you want to be pretty careful when you're going into there. A lot of guys get tempted to kind of use a wire brush that's a little bit bigger than the bore size, and they get in there and spin it around. Because the inside of that wire brush is attached to steel most of the time. So you want to be very careful with that crown. Again, like I said, you don't want to ding up that crown. So that muzzle brake or that flash suppressor will sort of protect your crown from outside objects or getting it dinged, like on the floor of a truck or whatever, things like that. But the second you introduce something in there to clean it out, make sure you're not hurting anything. So just take that into consideration as well. So after your rifle is all clean, and let's say you're going back out into the field, one thing you do need to be aware of, even with this minimal disturbance cleaning regime, is that after cleaning, before using it in the field again, you're going to need to fire, you know, 1 to 5 fouling shots before you want to use this thing for a field deployment, just to reestablish powder falling equilibrium. If you don't do this, what can happen is you can have a point of impact shift due to a pressure change because the frictional dynamics are going to be different without the carbon fouling in there. So you do want to make sure that it's fouled like it was when you had it zeroed, okay? And usually when you have all your zeros confirmed at various ranges and you have the rifle sighted in, it's not going to be on a perfectly clean, shiny bore. It will be when you have fired it a few times, right? So you're going to want to return to the field with identical bore conditions or as close to possible as identical bore conditions as you can so that you have a minimal change of your point of impact. And if you do all these things like we just said, you should have maintained your copper equilibrium. And then after your first couple fouling shots, you know, you can do that at base or you can do that before you go on a hunt or something, take it out to the range, take a shot or two before you got in the field. And you should be golden. And you shouldn't really even have to dial in very much of a cold bore correction or so-called cold bore correction, dirty bore correction, if your bore conditions are identical to when all your charts were confirmed, right? So that's the cool thing about this particular minimal disturbance cleaning regime is, for example, on my 338, I've got enough barrel rigidity to where even at long range, if I take a cold bore shot, there's not going to be any correction needed to account for that because a lot of, like we said before, a lot of what guys consider cold bore shots is just having that lack of powder fouling equilibrium. And so they have a real, real clean bore on that first shot, and it's going to hit significantly different than it will after you take the next few shots. So a lot of times that problem is misidentified. But if you do this minimal disturbance cleaning regime, the only thing you're possibly going to have to account for is barrel flex due to heat, and that's usually very minimal, unless you got a particularly stressed barrel that was poorly made. But if you're shooting any kind of high-quality rifle barrel, especially one rigid that's like kind of a heavy barrel, that's going to be an unmeasurable point of impact shift due to heat flex most of the time. So I pretty much eliminated the need for adjusting for so-called cold bore shots just by keeping track of my bore conditions and making sure that every time I go out and deploy the system, that first shot, I know exactly what bore conditions exist, and I'll be able to predict my muzzle velocity on the first shot, and my point of impact shift should be kept at a minimum. So that's pretty handy. Now, there's a second part to this cleaning regime, and that's copper remediation.